Hi there. Well, my internet keeps going away, so I'm going to try to just film up this and I'll post it later. But this is the dough for Pici, which was 2 cups of flour and like a little more than half a cup of water. I kneaded it until it was nice and rested, and it turns kind of white. I also put a tablespoon of oil in. And then you cut strips, which makes it really easy. You don't need any machines. And the strips you just roll out with your hands until you get a long, nice cord like this, okay? And you just do this all the time. So I'm using this pasta board. Hi there, sorry, internet keeps going away. So I'm going to just keep rolling and rolling and rolling, and I have my ragu on the side that I have in the freezer. I've got water boiling for the pasta, which I'll lightly salt. So these in Tuscany are called pici, sometimes they're called pinci, sometimes they're called ubriquelle, umbrique, strozza prete. And I just make these and I just leave them sitting on the side. I usually would take cookie sheets and then clean dish towels and lay them on the dish towels, which is really nice. And then some people like to roll them in semola flour, give them a little non-sticky kind of edge to them. But I find this works really, really well. And you don't want them to be too fat because they're going to plump up a little. Look, is that okay? Can you see? Here's on my hand. Nice and kind of thin. Not bigger than a chopstick, okay? And they're rustic pasta, so the traditional sauces would be a aglione, which is a really garlicky tomato sauce, usually with a little bit of chili pepper. So garlic, olive oil, chili pepper, and tomato, but really heavy on the garlic. They do ragu, any kind of ragu, which is really popular. And then we do the briciole, which is a garlic, olive oil, chili pepper, and breadcrumbs, a poor man's parmesan cheese, they sometimes call it. And that's quite popular down in Sicily, too. So anyway, you just keep making these, rolling, 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 and then they boil for about 3 minutes in water, salted water. And what I do then is I take them out of the water and I put them onto, right into the pan with the ragu, with a little bit of the pasta water. So if you see the ragu, there you go. You can see the ragu. The ragu isn't really tomato-y, so it needs a little more liquid, I think, in it. Okay? So I'll be posting this instead of my live. Okay? We're just going to keep rolling these. So you can see this makes a ton of pici. And depending what you're serving for dinner is how much you want to eat. Normally people eat about 80 grams of pasta, dry pasta that then is cooked. But they might have like 200 grams of potato gnocchi. I think that's a huge, huge portion. So we'll just see. I'm going to cut these all up and then roll them all out, toss them in the boiling water. Now, I think this is fun for a party. If you have the ragu made, have a nice salad, a dessert already done, and invite everybody in the kitchen to help you roll out the pasta. Okay? And it's really funny because, of course, you're supposed to be a better wife if you can roll these out really long. We're not going to go into that, right? Italian wives' tales. Okay, so these are just so easy. And there's even a rolling pin you could buy, which pre-cuts them for you. Kind of rolls down and evenly spaces them, so you don't have to worry about this. I don't think it's that hard to do without the rolling pin. It's a pretty wooden rolling pin, though, with ridges. Okay, I'm almost there. Okay. There we go. So you can see how much this makes. This makes a lot of them, okay? And just the texture, you get texture on the cutting board is why people do this. And sometimes if it's a little harder, you can just put it between your hands and roll it like this. Okay, oops, I can smell it. I put bread in earlier. Let me just check this now. You see? I think it needs a little more. It's not quite hollow yet. When I'm in the kitchen doing one thing, I want to do other things too. Okay? So my water's almost ready for me. The ragu is hot. I'm just going to add some of that when I take this out of the pasta water. When I take this out of the boiling water, I'll leave some of the pasta water to stretch the the sauce. So I like to make these smaller. Okay. I don't know what's wrong with the internet today. That's really kind of bad. I've got the Facebook Live on the other little telephone trying to reconnect. For some reason, the internet went out because we have Wi-Fi in the house. Sorry about losing. So this is going to be really weird Facebook Live. Okay, see how easy these are to roll out? It's almost like Play-Doh. It's really, really fun. So kids love this. Now I'll show you a couple of the other shapes you could do with this too, okay? Because when I go to Sicily, we do some flour and water pasta, but it's using the semola, the hard wheat flour. So it's a little bit different, but I'll show you the different shapes you can make. This is a nice and long one, see? It can get really long. And I put that little bit of oil in here to kind of help stretch it, so because my oven's on, it's kind of hot in here. So see, if it's long, I just kind of roll it up like this, lay it and space them. If the dough feels wet, you want to add more flour, okay? You just kind of learn how much you need. If it's a little too dry, if it's a little too wet. So I'm using kind of the palm of my hands. I loved working with clay when I was in art school, so this is all kind of fun for me too. Okay, I'm just going to make these all on the side here. And then I'll show you some other shapes. Sorry, this keeps going away. Every once in a while, that Facebook Live pops back in. Okay? So, like I said, depending on how much you're going to eat, if you're just going to have handmade pici and ragu for dinner and a nice salad, you want to have larger portions. And if you're going to be doing a multi-course meal with like a little crostini to start something on bread or roast meats or a second course and you know, a cooked vegetable and a salad and fruit and cheese or something. You know, it all depends on what you're serving, how big your portions should be. It's kind of easy. Okay. So this is being very good today, quite elastic and relaxing. So I'm using, I've got a little piece of wheat flour. I'm using 00 flour, which is a soft wheat flour, which they tend to use for pizza down in Naples. Not bread flour and not a hard wheat flour, but a soft wheat flour, and they tend to do a lot of water, sometimes 50 or 60% water. This is flour and with 50% water here, and if you were making the pizza dough, it would have yeast, and then would let rise, like usually overnight, to make a really nice digestible pizza dough. The least amount of yeast you put in, the better it is. So. Okay, so I'm just going to stop here, I think, now because this is a good example. I just have a few more to go, but I wanted to show you some of the other shapes, and I'll just kind of fake this for you. But usually they roll out a nice big thick one, and would cut them off a little piece with a knife. And then with the knife, they push down and away, and go like that, and then push it back up and over, and that would be like an orecchiette shape, the little ears. But when you've got Mama doing it with her her knife, it gets like a penny. She cuts off a penny, pushes it down the way with a knife. That's kind of fun. And then in Sicily, they do a thing called a busiate, which doesn't need to be very big. So the busiate would be like that. And then I don't think I have, let me see if I have a stick. I'll use my chopstick, but you would usually a little skewer level. Wrap this around. You see that? A little like skewer. Lightly push, and then slide it off. And that's a busiate. See that? Isn't that nice? And this would be served with a red pesto. Okay. Another thing that I like is called a cavatelli. And you would take this and with the back of your knife, kind of just push down and away. And it gets like a little shell shape, simple. And that could even be a bigger piece. And I should have a smaller knife with me, but. So they could be like that, cavatelli, kind of like the little orecchiette, the busiate. Okay, my water is boiling for the pasta, so let me show you. I'm going to salt the water. Salt it generously, because through osmosis, the flavor is going to get in there. Okay, and then I'm just going to take my pici and untangle them. Okay. And drop them into the boiling water. And then give it a stir. You don't want them to stick to each other. Okay. And like I said, they take 2 or 3 minutes. It's a fresh pasta, and it's just flour and water. There's really nothing to cook. It might be kind of like, you know, in northern part, they do a spätzle kind of thing. So this will float to the top when it's done. Okay. I'm going to reheat my ragu. I'll come over here and I'll show you. Okay. You can just do a few more of these. So then I'll have this on Facebook and also on my Dining with the Diva. And then eventually I put them all onto YouTube. See how quick they are to roll out? So again, you could do it on the cutting board. Or in your hands. The cutting board's going to give you a little more traction. Most people here have marble tables. And that's a little too slippery. So they have these wooden cutting boards called a pastillo, which you lay on top of your table. I'm going to keep going since I'm almost done now. Okay. So this is in real time. So you can see about 10 minutes. In a half an hour, I think you could have the pasta with your friends rolling it out. Bring the water to while the water's boiling. Heat up your ragu. Like I said, when I make ragu, I like to make it and have some and put it in the freezer. So whenever I get hungry, here I am. Let's say I forgot to even buy pasta. So with a cup of flour, I can really make pasta for the two of us. This is a kind of a large, I did 2 cups of flour, 200 grams of flour, with a little over a half a cup of water. Water weighs more than flour does. Okay. That one's going to break. We'll just break that off. They don't all have to be the same length. That's fine. We just have a couple more. 1, 2, 3. Okay. And I'll show you how much this made. This is the first time I've had bad time with the internet. That's too bad. We have a new Wi-Fi thing in the house. Here's my last piece. And because this is also fresh pasta, you don't need as much water to cook it in, but you do need salted water, okay, because that's going to give it flavor. I'll just throw these away. Okay. So right now, let me just bring you over here and show you. Let me do this. Need to turn this around. I haven't done this one in a long time. I'll just do it this way then. So here's the ragu. And there's the pasta boiling. Okay. So I'm going to stir the pasta. And it floats to the top. Let that cook for a minute. And then here, I have this really meaty ragu, not a lot of tomato sauce. Let me see if I can do this. I thought I should just be able to tap it. And it spins, but I guess not. It's like having a light show here. So there's the ragu. So what I'm going to do now is add a ladle of water.
Okay. Here. And that's going to loosen up the ragu. Okay. And then I'm going to add that little bit of Parmesan cheese that I pre-grated, parmigiano reggiano. Okay. That's going to melt in there and make it kind of creamy. And I have my, my little pincher thing. So I'm going to pick this right up. See how fat they got? Little fat earthworms, right? You'll see how fun this is as a pasta shape. And some of the water. Okay. You always want to keep some of your pasta water, okay? So I'm mixing this up, and then what this does is it also lets the pasta absorb some of the ragu and flavors the pasta. So we don't just throw the pasta sauce on the pasta. Hi, you guys. I'm sorry. Internet went away. I'll be posting. I'm doing a little video of everything, and I'll be posting this as a taped video. Okay? So see how that's absorbing all the ragu now and actually flavoring the pasta. Okay, so that's Pici a ragu, a Tuscan specialty, okay?